We're so glad you're here today. God has been blessing me this week. I trust he's been blessing you. Let's start with a word of prayer. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, as we come into your house today, we want to give you the honor and the glory and praise you deserve. Father, we are mere humans, mere mortals in this world, and yet you are God and you are awesome. And the best we got isn't good enough. But Father, we are your children. And so we know that you accept our praise, you accept our love as it is, and you will want to bless us. And so, Lord, as we've gathered, help us. Help us that we might sense your Holy Spirit. Help us, Lord, just to be calm inside of ourselves. Help us to be prepared and ready to receive all that you have to offer us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing together today.
Stand with me as we sing, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee."
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Heart unfold, our lives before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away.
Singing a song like that makes you feel glad to be alive in the service of the King of Glory. Praise his holy name. Constantly abiding. There's a peace in my heart that the world never gave. A peace it cannot take away. We'll sing the first, the third, and that's it. Well, we'll sing all the verses then. All right. Constantly abiding.
There's a peace in my heart that the world never gave. A peace it cannot take away. The trials of life may surround like a cloud. I'm a peace that has come here to stay.
Whisper also.
He's coming to take me some glorious day over there, my heavenly home. Constantly abiding, Jesus is mine. Constantly abiding, rapture divine. He never leaves me lonely, whispers oh so kind, I will never leave thee, Jesus is mine.
What a thought, praise the Lord, I will never leave thee, Jesus is mine.
Amen. In just a moment, our ushers will come and receive our tithes and offerings for the day. Just to remind you of some of the announcements this week. Tomorrow we have our Monday lunch for those who are less fortunate. We do pass out a hot sack lunch meal from here at the church from 12 to 12:30. On Tuesday at 11, we have our adult Bible study in the fellowship hall, and we have our board meeting at 1 p.m. On Wednesday is our ladies' luncheon for the month. That's at the Grand Buffet in Marysville. I believe that begins at 11:30. And then Friday from 2 to 4 here at the church, we have our youth group. So lots going on this week. Of course, we have our CA groups that meet as well, and our afternoon church here as well today as well. So lots going on in our church. Hope you're excited about that. Also wanted to remind you that Easter is just 3 weeks away. And so I want to remind you to not only plan to be here yourself for our Easter service, but also invite your friends and family. Easter is one of those times of the year where people are almost expecting an invite or looking for an invite. They're certainly more welcome or more open to receiving an invite and coming on the Easter Sunday. And so that's just 3 weeks away on March 31st. So ushers, if you'll come, we'll pray and receive our offering. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is to not only be in your house, but to participate in the worship, in your worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Father, you have blessed and given us so much. And so as we give back this small portion to you, we pray that you would once again take it and bless it. Bless it in the ministries in this church, but also the ministries across the country and around the world through the giving to the Church of Nazarene. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. With that, we'll invite you to stand and greet one another in love. At the same time, we'll dismiss our children to Children's Church.
sing that together as we find our spot together. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joined heirs with Jesus, travel this on, for I'm part of the family, the family of God. Let's sing that one more time, and please find your place to sit.
I'm so glad I'm a part.
Proves it is to be part of the family of God, that wherever we go and we find a church of the Nazarene, we're always welcome as part of the family. But you know, it's not just our church, it's Christian churches, that we have brothers and sisters around the world who love the same Jesus we love, who have accepted His salvation into their lives, and one day we'll rejoice together in heaven with all of them. Praise God for that. We have our responsive reading coming up. It's justification by faith. Won't you read with me responsibly? Since we've been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And perseverance produces character. Hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out His love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom He has given to us. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man. But God demonstrated His own love for us in this. We rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. May the Lord add His blessing to this reading from His Word.
This next gospel song is Standing on the Promises of God, but just sit. And we're standing on the inside, we're singing, standing, the first and the second and the last verses, please.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. On the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail, resting on the Lord and fear assail. By the living word of God I shall prevail, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
And the last,
standing on the promises of God, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior, all in all, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God.
I know that for many of you that felt awfully strange, singing about standing while sitting. But thank the Lord, we know in our hearts that His promises do not fail. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. In a moment, Pastor is going to come and lead us in our prayer time. And as we prepare for prayer, we're going to sing, God is so good. And as we sing, think about the goodness of God to you this past week and worship Him and give Him your needs and requests. God is so good.
God is so good. As I go before the Lord this morning, just a few things I wanted to remind you of. We are praying for Roy Fulton as he is waiting for test results and with the cancer that he has. Just praying that God's healing and protection over him. And so we want to pray for him today. Also, for Rachel's brother, Floyd, he is in his final hours, if you will, before he gets to meet Jesus. But the good news is she just shared with me that he received Jesus in his heart this week or in the last couple weeks. And so praise God, we know it's never too late, that as long as we have the breath of life, that God accepts us into His kingdom. And so we are celebrating with Floyd today as he will be with Jesus soon. I want to pray for Harry's daughter, Vicky, as she is still trying to recover from the surgery she had a month ago. And God is blessing her, but want her to come see her farther. And we want to pray for Greta today, who I heard this morning was in a car accident on top of falling a few weeks back. And so we want to pray for her. Also, I got to see Rosetta this week, and if you know Rosetta, she's dealing with dementia quite heavily. She does kind of remember some scripture and some songs that we tried to sing together, but just pray for her and for her family. And then, I guess last but not least, Shirley has surgery tomorrow, and so we want to lift her up today, and I just pray God's blessings upon the surgery and her recovery coming up. So let's pray today. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, what a privilege to come before You in prayer. Father, we've come as the body of Christ on this corner, on this community, in this city, in this county, and Father, how we love Jesus. And Father, as we bring these requests before You, we know that You are the God of heaven and earth. We know that You speak into the lives of the billions of people that are alive today. We know that You are greater than our minds can even begin to fathom, and that as You hear each voice, as You hear each request, as You hear Your people speak, Lord, that You already have in mind how to answer those prayers. So, Father, we give You praise in advance for being this kind of a God. And we thank You for all that You're about to do. And we thank You for the opportunity to voice them to You, knowing, oh God, that You want to hear our voice. You never look upon us as if we're wasting Your time or taking up space. But You've created us to be in relationship with You. And so, Lord, we come before You, not only as our God, but also as our Father. As our daddy is the one that we love back, who first loved us. Father, today, we pray for these we've mentioned today. We think today of Roy. We think of the pain that he's in. And we think that You're a healing God, or we know that You're a healing God, Lord. Reach out and touch his body right now. Father, take away the pain and help him as he goes through this. And Father, we pray for a healing upon his body. We pray that Your will be done, but may that will include a healing upon him. Father, we thank You for this good news about Floyd, and we rejoice with the angels that we hear that he's been saved and believe that he will be with You soon. Father, as You prepare to receive him into heaven, we look forward to the day we'll get to see him again. But please be with his family right now as they are preparing to say goodbye. We thank You, Lord, for all that You're about to do in this family situation. We think of Vicky today, Lord, who's had this brain surgery and now still trying to recover. We thank you for being with her thus far and pray you would continue to be with her. Father, bring her back to the full mental capacity and the ability to do all the things that she used to do. Thank you for being with her as well. We pray today for others, Lord, who need your touch. We think of Brenda today, who is at home and now been in this car accident after falling. We pray that you would touch her body and help her to recover fully that way, and help her, Lord, that she might get the things done so she can be with us again soon. We thank you, Lord, for Rosetta and the opportunity to spend a few minutes with her, and pray, Lord, for her that you would continue to minister to her inside this terrible disease. We know, Lord, that she's still in the palm of your hands, and we're grateful, Lord, for all that you're doing in her life as well. Father, today we pray for Shirley. We think of the surgery she has tomorrow and as she's at home today preparing for it. We miss her here, Lord, but she's probably watching online. And we just pray that your blessing would just surround her right now, that she would just feel the powerfulness of your spirit, that you would just hold her up in your arms and hold her close to your chest. And Father, as she prepares for surgery tomorrow, may you be with the doctors and the nurses who will take care of her. May you prepare their hands to do the work you created them to do. May the surgery go well and the recovery even better. We pray for Pastor Campbell as he nurses her, Lord, and brings her back to health, that you would give him the strength that he needs in order to do so, and just bless this wonderful family in our church. Father, thank you for all that you're about to do in their lives. For others, Lord, that I have maybe have failed to mention, or maybe I don't know, but we know there's many in our families or in our workplaces or schools that need your touch. We pray right now that you would bless each one, Father, in need, and draw them close to your heart as well. We thank you, O God, that you know us better than we know ourselves. And so we simply place ourselves in your hands. Father, today we're thankful for the freedoms we have and for the country we live in, as we think of elections that are taking forth this week. And even though they're primary in nature, Father, we want to do your will. So we pray that you open our hearts and our minds, that we would vote according to your plan. And we pray, Lord, that you'd bring forth candidates of your choosing to lead our country that opens a door for a revival. And as we pray for that revival, Lord, we pray for the pastors and for the teachers and for those standing in your churches or in your behalf, Lord, preaching the word. Father, may you fill them with your power. May your Spirit's power come upon your people. And may we see a mighty revival take place in this land. Father, today we pray for our school in Jackson Elementary and other schools we might represent. We pray for the students specifically, that you would bless them, protect those that are maybe in bad situations, but fill the hearts and fill the bodies of those who may be hungry. But Lord, may they find love at school. May they find your peace at school. May your love just surround this entire school community. Be with the teachers and the staff workers and the administration and all the volunteers. And we just pray that your will would be done. Father, we just thank you for the opportunities that are before us. And we thank you for those who serve us, for the brave men and women of our military service, for the police officers and firefighters and EMTs here at home. Please bless and watch over each one and bring them home safely. Father, today we just pray for our church family, for the people sitting in front of us and the people behind us, for the people on our right and for the people on our left, for each need that's here before you today, whether it's in the pew or in the altar. We give them to you, and we thank you for all that you're about to do. And we ask for all these things in the beautiful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. If you'll turn in your Bible to 1 Timothy chapter 4. Today I want to read to you from verses 11 to 16. All right. 1 Timothy chapter 4, we're going to start at verse 11. If you can, please stand for the reading of God's word. Command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. Do not neglect your gift, which was given through a prophetic message when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourselves wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Father God, as we break this bread of life, and you shared it with me this week, speak to us anew and afresh about how we live out our faith in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let me ask you a question to begin with today. What's the scariest thing about living in America today? Could it be the ideology that freedom of speech is limited to what someone may want to hear? There's a movie that came out like in 1995, I think it was called The American President. And Michael Douglas played the part of President Andrew Shepard in the movie, and he made this speech. He said, America isn't easy. America is advanced citizenship. You got to want it bad because it's going to put up a fight. It's going to say you want free speech. Let's see you acknowledge a man whose words make your blood boil, who's standing center stage and advocating at the top of his lung that which you would spend a lifetime opposing at the top of yours. That's free speech. Promote that in your classrooms. You know, one of this country's foundations set forth by its founding fathers is the right to free speech. We may not like what someone else has to say, but let them have the opportunity to say it. But as a country, we appear to have forgotten what that means. Today, so many people live in fear of what they can say and what the consequences will be for them if they do something deemed to be unpopular with one side or the other. And I wonder, too, if the same thing can be said about our Christian faith. Has it been stifled by those who profess the ideology that you have the right to freedom of religion as long as you keep it to yourself? Did you hear what I said there? We have people out there who are basically spreading a message that says you have the right to a freedom to believe what you want to believe as long as you keep it to yourself, if I don't like it. And yet when we read the New Testament, we learn that the essence of being a Christian is following Jesus Christ in a very public way. Although we have a private relationship with Jesus, following Jesus has implications for how we do business, how we pay our taxes, how we deal with conflict, how we raise our family, and so on and so forth. In Luke 9:29, Jesus himself told us that if we're embarrassed of him, he'll be embarrassed of us. Now, that wasn't exactly his words, but that's the point of his message. Yet it seems that embarrassment is the way a lot of people feel about their faith. Our faith is not necessarily something we share outright firsthand, but maybe something that comes later, maybe something that shares once we start building a relationship. But the New Testament calls us to live out our faith. The New Testament calls for people to know us by our faith. And the New Testament calls for us to say, hey, I believe in Jesus and I want people to know it. Not to force my ways upon them, but so they might see Jesus. The truth is that it's impossible to live the life of following Jesus prescribed in the Bible in total privacy. So how do we make our faith in Jesus public? Is it simply by putting on a bumper sticker on our car or a cross around our neck or a WWJD wristband? Remember those old wristbands that say, what would Jesus do? Or maybe even today people get a tattoo to proclaim their faith. Well, today we're going to look at how to make our faith in Jesus public in ways that go beyond bumper stickers, t-shirts, or even tattoos. You see, the problem with these other approaches is not that they're too extreme, but that they're not extreme enough. They don't get to the real heart of the issue of what public faith looks like for Jesus. If you've been here these last several weeks, we're going through this New Testament book of 1 Timothy, and we've discovered so far that a deepened life with God comes as a result of accurate beliefs, spiritual practices, and authentic Christian community. Today, we'll look at four ways to make our faith in Jesus Christ public. The first way to make our faith in Jesus Christ public is by our example. In verse 11 and 12, it says, command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. Now, we don't know for sure that Timothy was struggling with being a young pastor called to confront issues dealing with the elders in the church. But it is an issue that many young pastors face early in ministry. If you think about it, oftentimes pastors, young men or young women, go to school right out of college. They graduate from college at the age of 22. For many of those, they go on to seminary in Kansas City if they're in the Church of the Nazarene. And by the age of 25 or 26, they're out in the field of work. Hopefully they've been called to a church. I was a little older when I got into my first church, but I remember in the age of 32, I believe I was, and standing there before people who are in their 50s, 60s, and 70s, and thinking, okay, God has called me to lead these people, and it's an awesome task, an awesome responsibility, and somewhat intimidating at times. And so I think Paul is really doing here is reminding Timothy and encouraging Timothy to say, God has called you. You are my child. And of course, Paul kind of thought Timothy as his adopted son, if you will. But it's really God saying, you are my child and I've called you. And it's not, oh, by the way, it's not just about Timothy, but God has called each one of us when we walk into the kingdom of God to be his children. The reality is that Timothy can't stop people from looking down on him because of his age, but Timothy can choose not to be intimidated by the elders in the church. And since Timothy can't control other people's attitude toward him, he should focus on his own attitude. Instead of being intimidated, Paul wants Timothy to set an example. In other words, Timothy is to live as an example of what a believer in Jesus Christ looks like. Folks, that's what each one of us are called to do. To live out our faith by how we live our life. Now, if you think about it, being an example is profoundly public activity. Something we do in the midst of others. So this text is more than encouraging a young pastor, it's an encouragement to all of us. And Paul lists several things in verse 12 where our personal example is especially important. The first is in speech. Now, you've probably heard this before, but how we talk is a window into our souls. Do you believe that? Can I be honest with you this morning? Sometimes I feel like an old soul. Maybe I feel like I could have been born in a previous generation, but how people speak sometimes really gets to me. When I, and our kids, you know, they watch their music stuff, and when I see young people talking and I hear them saying some of the phrases they're saying and some of the way they want to say things, I just cringe inside. I just feel like they don't get what's looked upon. And I know that we can sit back and say, you know, I don't want to be controlled. I want to do it my way. I want to say the things I want to say. And I by no way am saying that I'm perfect in my speech. But I think we represent Christ in everything we do. And so when the words flow out of our mouth that are dishonoring to God, that points to God. I believe it's in the book of James where it says, how can fresh water and salt water come out of the same voice? And so there's this idea in speech that, yes, we have the freedom to speak, but we need to speak as if we're speaking for God. That when it comes down to the tough things in life, do we gossip about people? Do we talk about people? Do we question people's motives? Is that what we're called to do? Or rather, as Christians, are we to build people up? Are we to encourage people? The truth is, we're even called sometimes to admonish people in the name of God, but we admonish them in a way that is to build them up, not tear them down. It's how we speak represents Christ. The second thing mentioned is conduct. What kind of decisions do you make throughout the day? Decisions about what you do with your time, decisions about how you spend your money, how you handle interruptions at work, what kind of entertainment you enjoy. That all talks about our conduct. Does our conduct represent Christ? Now, Paul says that in Christ, everything is permissible, but not everything is beneficial. So the fact is, you can stand here, and I won't argue with this, says, I can do whatever I want. Yes, you can. But you are a temple of the living God, and when you say I belong to Christ, it's representative by what you do. Do we really expect that people are going to want to know our Jesus if we are representing things that they don't like? If we're out doing things that don't show a loving God, if we're dishonest in our business dealings, if we're struggling with our personal relationships, does that honor God? We need to be aware that God is at the forefront of all that we do. The third is much like that, and it says in love. It's talking about all of our relationships. Let me ask you a question. Are you difficult to be around at times? Are you pushy? Are you demanding of your own way? Are you controlling or manipulative? Or are we open and flexible, choosing to be loving and patient with people? The quality of our personal relationships is also a window into our soul. The fourth thing mentioned is in faith. And of course, that refers to our attitude toward God. When the bottom falls out of our lives, do we respond with trust or distrust toward God? Do we act as if we really believe God is good to us and is caring for our needs? Folks, this is a big one. You know, there's lots of people who are Christians at work and live that Christian faith, but when it comes time to a struggle, they kind of fail, don't they? People aren't really looking to see how well you follow Christ in the good times. They want to know how well you follow Christ when things aren't so good. The truth is, if they're going to know Jesus as we know Jesus, they want to know how it is to know Jesus when the times are tough. Wouldn't it be great if once we became Christians, we never had to deal with cancer anymore or any kind of disease? Wouldn't it be great if once we became Christians, our kids never fought anymore or never argued? Wouldn't it be great if our relationships always went well and we always got the promotion at work? But you know, the fact is, that's not how life works. And the truth is, if becoming a Christian meant all those things, people would become a Christian for all the wrong reasons. We become Christians when we accept and receive that Jesus Christ is Lord. When we ask Him to be the Lord of our life. When we say, we're going to follow You no matter what. I heard this in the last 2 weeks, and maybe I shared it last week, but it still is a profound thought in my head. It's this idea that if you think about the Old Testament, God didn't save Daniel from the lion's den. He saved Daniel in the lion's den. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego still went to the fiery furnace, but God saved them inside the fiery furnace. And maybe we think, well, why didn't God save them ahead of time? We don't know, but maybe it's to show us as well that sometimes God's going to save us in the midst of the event rather than before the event. You see, just because we're Christians doesn't mean we don't face hard times in life. What it means is that we don't face them alone. What it means is we don't have to stress and struggle and worry if this is the end, because it's never the end with God. And what it means for others is that when they see us and they see God protect us, that God can protect them as well. The last thing he mentions is impurity. And this refers to our moral purity. In other words, is our sexual choices within the boundaries that God has set up for us? Do we honor God with our bodies and our minds in the midst of a world that says there's no limitations? In the midst of a world that says, do whatever you want, it doesn't matter. Are we honoring God? All of these things point to be an example of what a follower of Jesus looks like in public action. As Christians, we're called to be in the world, but not of the world. That means that our lives, our example, should point people to Jesus. The second way to make our faith in Jesus Christ public is our roadmap, if you will. Verse 13, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching, and to teaching. And of course, Paul's worship referring to the public worship service in the church of Ephesus, but this doesn't just apply to preachers. What we find here is a principle for all followers of Jesus. Our faith in Jesus is public in our commitment to the Bible. You see, the fact that the Christian church publicly reads from the Bible during worship and that preachers try to communicate the Bible demonstrates the foundational role that the Bible has in the Christian life. As a Christian, the Bible should be a roadmap for our way of living. Do you agree? If we look at it that way, then the Bible is not just a collection of scattered stories and wise sayings that we sift through and pick out the good stuff. Instead, we take the whole Bible, all 66 books, as a roadmap for our life. Our commitment to the Bible makes our faith public. More than a t-shirt or a Bible verse or a tattoo with John 3:16, I've talked about actually using the Bible as our roadmap. I think this morning I heard it said, or maybe I say it said, that if you see a person with a rarely used Bible, they're probably on the right path with God. Do we pick up our Bibles anymore? Now, I know with our phones, you know, we pull up the Bible apps, and I'm not against that for sure, but are we using our Bible? You know, it's funny today that we all have GPSs, and maybe some of you don't use it. I have a buddy from South Carolina. He's actually in town visiting with his mom, but he almost refuses to follow the map on his phone. And he makes fun of me because I always follow the map. I'm like, well, if there's an accident, I get around the accident, or I don't have to really remember. And we just go to it. I plug it in, even across town sometimes, what's the fastest way, and it'll guide me right there. Yeah, for my buddy, sometimes he gets lost. Sometimes he takes a wrong turn and he just laughs it off, and which is all okay for driving. But what about following God's roadmap? Do we pull out the Bible whenever we're thinking about something and say, hey, what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say is the best way to go? What is the Bible calling me to do? How did God respond when someone else was dealing with a similar situation? The Bible's meant to be at our fingertips. The Bible's meant to be there to lead and to guide our basic principles in life. And the truth is, it's good for others to see that. Why is it that we want others to know that we have this relationship in Jesus Christ? Is it because we think they're going to praise us? Heavens, no. If that's the case, we need to talk. It's because we want them to see how good life can be if Jesus is in charge. We want them to see how good life can be if God is at the head. The reason we use our Bible as a roadmap in front of others is so they can see how good it is to know Jesus. The third way to make our faith in Jesus public is in our service. In verse 14, do not neglect your gift, which is given you through prophecy when the body of elders laid their hands on you. If you remember back in chapter 1, we talked about how Timothy had come to faith in Jesus at a very young age through the influence of his mother and grandmother. And of course, if you know the story of Paul, you remember that Paul had a dramatic conversion experience much later in life. Timothy, having grown up in the church, probably struggled to know exactly when he first started believing in Jesus. I think I was probably 8 years old the first time I came to the altar to pray and ask Jesus into my heart as a kid at church. I don't have that moment where I can say, I remember doing this, I remember this great epiphany happening, and I know that I came many times and prayed and asked Jesus into my heart as I was trying to grow up and learn, and all those are valid. But for Timothy, for those who have grown up at church maybe our whole lives, maybe we don't have a watershed moment like that. For Timothy, his watershed moment, if you will, is when these people, these elders, laid their hands on him and commissioned him to do the work of God. In the Church of Nazarene, we call this ordination. And once you've got your schooling done and you've kind of had your internship done or your apprenticeship done, if you will, and get some time in, then we're examined by elders in the church. And if we're found to be worthy as men or women of God and called into ministry, then we are ordained. And at district assembly every year, there's a special service where we as elders in the church lay our elders and deacons in the church lay our hands on people and commission them. And once commissioned to the church, we can then represent the Church of Nazarene anywhere in the world. Do not neglect the gift that God has for you. The Greek text of this verse literally is, do not neglect the gift that is for you. Timothy here was reminded by Paul that he received this sort of spiritual gift, a divine empowerment from God to be used for service that is now in him. Can I tell you today, that's for all of us? Can I tell you that's not just reserved for pastors or even Sunday school teachers or the like? When we become Christians, the Bible tells us we're all given spiritual gifts. Why is that? Because God has a place for you. Because God has a part for you. Because God wants you to be a part of the body of Christ. Do you know that we're all part of a body of Christ? Where we choose to worship makes us part of the body of Christ. Now maybe I'm the mouth because I got the big mouth, right? I'm the one out here standing and preaching. But I can't do it all. And in Scripture, it talks about one being the hand and one being the foot and different parts of the body. The fact is, God has given you a gift to use in this place, in this body of Christ, so that we can be whole, so that we can reach out to others. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 to 7 says, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but same God works all of them in all men and women. If you've trusted in Jesus Christ, you also have a gift of the Spirit. A service from the Lord, a working God wants to work through you in the lives of others. The fact is, God gives Christian spiritual gifts to be used in the church so that as followers of God, we can help each other. God wants every follower of Jesus Christ to have an interdependent relationship with his or her church. A relationship where the Christian receives service from others in the church and where the Christian provides service for others. Can I share with you today that this is where I struggle with online worship? Online worship is great. Hopefully, Miss Shirley's watching at home. She has surgery tomorrow. She can't be here. If you're sick and you can't make it to service, we want you to watch online. But I worry about people who don't come in lieu of just sitting at home in their PJs watching services. And I know that we don't have maybe none in our church or very few in our church, but you miss out when you're not here. You miss out when you don't have a local body of Christians where you are ministering with, where you are ministering to and being ministered to. There are times, if you will, in my life where I've come to church as almost a last resort. I need to be surrounded by people who would love me and love me through and pray me through some tough act. And certainly I've been there on the other side of it. If you're a person who's watching online and from a faraway place and don't have a local body of Christ, let's find one for you. A place where you can be a member. A place where you can be ministered to and minister and use the gift. Unfortunately, most churches today operate on a 20-80 principle. It's where 20% of the members do 80% of the work. Sometimes that's just because people don't know what their gifts are. And if you don't know what your gifts are today, let me know or talk to someone else. Let's help find out what those gifts are and how we can use you. The fourth way to make our faith in Jesus Christ public is our own progress. In verses 15 and 16, we read, "Be diligent in these matters. Give yourselves wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers." Here, Paul is challenging Timothy to a total commitment to these instructions. These aren't just suggestions, but they're commands, absolutely essential for Timothy and essential to our lives as well. Our obedience to these commands will make our progress in the spirit life evident for everyone to see. Far too often, we think we need to be perfect before we go public with our faith in Jesus. You know, there is a strong misconception that I'm afraid to share my faith or share that I have faith because I don't want to damage the kingdom of God. Is that true? I'm afraid that if I go out there and I share it with people at work who I am as a Christian, and then I fail later on in the day, that they're not going to like me anymore. They're not going to believe in God anymore. Can I tell you that that's a lie of the devil? The truth is, God wants us to go as our imperfect persons into our workplace, into the world, to show who we are. And when we fail, what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to make amends. We're supposed to apologize and ask forgiveness when we need to. At the same time, when we fail, we show that we're human. The truth is, if we always come across as perfect in our life with Christ, then people can't relate to us. I want people to know that I'm not perfect. I want people to know that all that I am is simply a man who's been called of God, an imperfect man who's been called of God, saved by grace. And God has gifted me and with the ability to share. The fact is that people need to see other people living for Jesus. They need to see our public lives and our public living out our lives so they too can understand that they can have Jesus. I'm sure I've confessed this before, and I'll say it again, not as against this church, but, you know, I grew up in this church, and as a teenager in this church, I knew all the right things to say, and I was trying my best to live for God, and yet I had this belief inside me that if I was to die, I would never make it to heaven. And part of the reason for that is because I had this misconception at church that everybody at church was perfect. You see, I didn't realize that people struggled when they were outside the church, and everybody... You know, everybody did well at church. And it wasn't until I became an adult and got to know people better and started to realize that they weren't perfect. They were simply loved by Jesus. They'd simply given themselves over to God and doing their best. And when I realized that, then I was able to understand that God could save me as well. I say all that to say that it's important that we live our public life so that people see us. And this progress that he's talking about with Timothy is the same progress he's talking about with us. That as we live out our life, as we become more and more like Christ, people see that. So why go to Bible study? Why go to Sunday school? Why even go to church? Because we already have this relationship with God. It's because I want to progress in my relationship with God. It's because I want to get closer to Christ. And as I do, hopefully others will want that as well. Not because of who I am, but because of what God does in me. We mentioned this in Sunday school this morning, but we said that we don't save anybody. I can't save you. Do you know that? I can't save anybody. The saving work is done by Jesus Christ and his death on the cross and his resurrection. And I can't save anybody, and I can't take anybody away from God. What I can do, though, is I can show people my way. And I can point people to God through the way I live my life. And that's what we're called to do. We're called to live our lives as an example to Him. But there's only one problem with that. If we really want to live our lives and as an example to God, as an example of Jesus Christ, we have to be obedient. Does anybody like to be obedient? Is that our favorite thing to do? Is that like in the marriage vows or something, I will obey when I want to? No. It's this idea, though, that when we come to Christ, we're saying to Him, I want to give you everything. We don't make Jesus the Lord of our Christian life, right? We don't make Jesus the Lord of the time we spend at church or the Lord of Sundays. We make Jesus the Lord of our life. We give Him lordship over our whole life. The problem with living in the free country we live in is that we don't understand what it means to live under a king. There are countries, even in the world today, where there's a respect, if you will, for God. There's a fear, if you will, of God. I heard it said of a Christian man who was a, let's just say, a big personality. Many people knew who he was. And back in the 90s, he what we call fell from grace, had a big issue. And, of course, it was public and a big thing kind of ensued from it. He met with another pastor a few months after all this was going on. And the pastor said to him, "What made you stop loving Jesus?" And this pastor looked at his friend that came to see him and says, "What do you mean?" And this visiting pastor said, what made you stop loving Jesus so much that you were willing to let all these other things happen? And the guy looked at him and said, "I never stopped loving Jesus. I just didn't fear God." And I wonder if that's the problem in America today. Not that people don't love Jesus, because people do love Jesus. Not as many as we'd like, of course. We want more people every day to come in. But people have seemed to have lost this fear of God. Folks, heaven and hell are real things. Heaven and hell are real, and we believe it. And when our time on earth is done, we will stand before an almighty God who will look at our heart and tell us the desires of our heart. And we either know Jesus as our personal Savior, and if we do, His blood on the cross has come down to save us, or we don't. We have to know Jesus, and we have to fear God. Jesus gave His life so that we could have life. That should be enough for us to be 100% obedient to Him. But Pastor, you don't understand. I don't want to give this area of my life up, or it shouldn't matter that I do this over here. This shouldn't be a big deal. I hear you, but what did God do for you? Jesus gave His life so that you could have life. Shouldn't we be willing to give our entire life? And shouldn't we be willing to do it in a public way? I seen something online the other day. Isn't it great that we have online all these things pop up? But they are sometimes nice reminders. But someone online posted a little picture that said, "If you're not struggling as a Christian, maybe you're a struggling Christian. The devil is not working on you, then maybe it's because he doesn't think he needs to." Are we serving God today publicly the way we should? In just a moment, we're going to sing this song, the Lord's Prayer. Before that, though, let's just pray and ask God to examine our hearts and make sure we're living out our life the way we should. Father God, thank You for this day. Thank You for this reminder that we are called to live out our faith publicly. And even though, Lord, there's times when it sure feels like it's the wrong thing to do, there's times when maybe our voices are stifled or we're not able to say exactly what we want to say, may we always live out our life for You. May our lives be a living example of what You mean to us. And even though imperfect, may our lives be an example of what they could have as well. Father, would You transform us to be more like Christ in every way in our progress so that others will see Jesus, that we might become less and He might become more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand if we can, and let's sing this song together. The song's by Matt Mayer. It's called the Lord's Prayer. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Verse 4. When we've been there 10,000 years, when shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first Father God, it is by your amazing grace that we are able to say we believe in you, that we are able to call ourselves sons of the living God and daughters of the living God. Father, now as we go from this place, we pray, O God, that your spirit would be upon us, that your hand would lead and guide us, and that we will be obedient to you in everything we do. Father, may you fulfill us and prepare us today for what's to come tomorrow, but give us opportunity to love one another, to love those out there who don't know you. And may our lives point them to you that they too might know Jesus. Thank you for all that you're about to do. Bring us back together next week that we might celebrate all that you've accomplished this week in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you and thank you for being here today.